What's going on, guys? JD at JD's Custom Buggies.
I want to take a minute to talk about something that I've, over the phone, talking to customers, trying to troubleshoot stuff or explain stuff over the phone. Sometimes it gets to be difficult, and I talk to people with all kinds of mechanical skill levels. So some people, pretty much, you can say something when you're trying to explain it to them, they get it right away, and other people don't. And one of the things that a lot of people get confused by, especially if this is kind of new to them, is they hear terms and they're kind of confused about what the terms are. So what I want to do is talk about the difference in compression, vacuum, and crankcase pressure. And the reason why I figured it's a subject to talk about is I want to try and really dumb it down to you, explain it to you simply, at least the way I see it. And I'm not an engine builder. I can't go and just work on anything. I'm fairly mechanically skilled because it just has always interested me in my life. But I'm constantly learning things every day, something new. So I figured the best way to explain it is just how the way I try to simplify it in my head as much as I can. And it just helps me be able to troubleshoot, diagnose stuff. When it comes to wiring, I kind of look like wiring is plumbing. Your current or your signal is coming from point A to point B. You follow it through the wiring harness, just basically like you would pipes that were, you know, carrying imaginary water. So see if I can kind of quickly explain this to you. And the reason why I just figured it was necessary is because when I'm talking about compression, or I'm talking about vacuum, or I'm talking about crankcase pressure, most people get those three things confused. Some people think it's all the same thing. Some people will say I'm losing compression because, you know, if we diagnose a vacuum leak, they're like, well, I get more compression now that we fixed it. No, because it's completely different. So this might help troubleshoot some problems. So we'll start with vacuum, because vacuum basically starts at the top. And the vacuum is basic. And I had to look up the definition because I didn't want to screw it up. The other two I can explain. I really don't need the definition. But vacuum, it is what I thought. But vacuum basically is the suction, or what the definition is vacuum is actually the difference in the pressure inside the manifold versus its atmospheric pressure, or where the motor is. So it's basically the pressure difference between inside this intake and its surrounding environment. So you have a carburetor that connects to the intake manifold. Basically, as how I look at it, if I were to dumb it down, I look at it as the suction, or the pressure coming in. Now, you have a carburetor here, it's sucking air and it's sucking fuel, and it's mixing it in the carburetor. The pressure from the carburetor to the intake valve is basically where your vacuum is created, okay? And vacuum can be used, like on automobiles, if you notice that all the vacuum fittings come from the intake manifold. And you can run, brake assist, your power brakes, vacuum assisted brakes. That pressure is coming from the manifold. Trying to think of what else. I'm not an auto mechanic, so right off the top of my head, I'd have to sit down and sit there and scratch my head. But in our circumstance here with the GY6 motors, with buggies, with scooters, things that take this motor, you're basically running vacuum fuel pumps off this, off your intake manifold, and you'll notice on your intake you have nipples, okay? I haven't blocked off on this motor because it's getting a slide carb, and you won't need it, but if you notice, I got an Allen bolt here that's blocking off my intake, or my vacuum. So basically what the nipples are for, you know, the run of the diaphragms on your CV, your stock carbs, your CV carbs, the little petcock under the tank, basically acts as a fuel pump. They're also external, like on GY6 UTVs, because the tank is mounted under a seat, you'll have an actual designated fuel pump that runs off engine vacuum and basically runs a diaphragm that pumps the fuel in, that's below the motor and pushes it up into the carburetor, pushes it uphill. So we have vacuum. Now, why is it, what problems can extenuate if you're trying to track down a problem? What would cause vacuum? Well, you want this seal, okay? So anything any issue that you're going to get created by vacuum would be a leak. Okay, so where would it leak? There's a couple different places. Some are easy to find, some not so easy to find. So if you are running vacuum accessories like a pump or whatnot, then yeah, check your vacuum lines first, okay? Vacuum lines check out, then where I would go would be if you have a two-piece, like a performance intake manifold, you have a boot, check your clamps, check your bolts, I'll hold the boot on. The other place it could be the stock spacer, the what's called an isolator bushing, that basically underneath your intake you have a rubber O-ring. If you mounted that O-ring right to the head, it would melt. So there's what's called an isolator bushing. You'll see these on a lot of motorcycles and ATVs also, where there's like a plastic spacer or some sort of spacer between the intake and a carb. And what that does is it basically disperses heat to keep the O-ring from melting. All right, and usually it has a gasket on one side and then the O-ring from either your carburetor or your intake on the other side. In this case, the gasket goes under the spacer, then the spacer, and then the intake. But those bushings, they get heat fatigued and they start to crack. I've actually seen brand new ones crack. Let's say you're changing your pieces out, all right? You're changing your spacer, you're changing your intake, and you do not scrape the gasket. You don't do a good job of scraping your gasket off. And then cinch down on your intake with that spacer in there. That little difference in gasket, torque down hard enough, will actually crack that spacer, all right? If you look on the website, gotbuggies.com, I actually make aluminum, or I have them made, but they're aluminum spacers, all right? Aluminum dissipates heat great, and the other thing is you don't have to worry about it cracking or ever getting heat fatigued, all right? You should only have to buy one. You should be able to use that for the rest of your life. But now, what will a vacuum leak cause, or what are the symptoms of having a vacuum leak? Okay, for one, having a vacuum leak might give you difficulty in A, getting the motor to start, all right? It might not start at all, just because there's too much air, and that's what you're doing, is basically a vacuum leak is sucking air in, and it's basically causing your carburetor to have a very lean condition, okay? And the reason why is the carburetor is basically taking in the air and fuel mixture. And when you're tuning your carb and you get it all tuned and dialed in and whatnot, it means you have a really good fuel and air mixture. You know, the motor runs, purrs like a kitten, it revs great, does everything it's supposed to do. You've got probably close to a perfect air fuel mixture, okay? By sucking in air, either through the gasket, bad lines, intake, boot, something, that extra air will cause it to throw the mixture off. So much so that the motor won't start. You might pull the choke and get it to start and it'll rev to high hell. And as soon as you close the choke off, it'll die, okay? And the reason what you're doing is you're adding the extra fuel from choking it to compensate for all that extra air you're sucking in that you don't know about or shouldn't be there. Another symptom, it might start, but rev real high. All right, and it all depends on how much air. These different symptoms are just—it's all vacuum leak. It just depends on how much air or how big your vacuum leak is. Too big a vacuum leak, you're not starting at all. A more slight vacuum leak, yeah, it might start and rev. All right. Now, why would it rev if it's getting less fuel and more air? Well, let's say good example: lawnmower or weed whacker or chainsaw. When the tank's going empty, even a dirt bike. When the tank is going empty, you can almost hear it, the idle lift, okay? And the reason why, it's getting leaner. Lean is mean. I mean, you know, adding air, you know, to your mixture, but too lean is not good. But what I'm saying is, as you're running out of fuel and sucking more air, it's revving up, because basically the mixture has changed. And usually a leaner condition will rev up, will rev higher. So like if you've ever been weed whacking, not paying attention, and all of a sudden weed whacker starts to rev up before it dies, and that's what it's doing. It's getting lean, it's sucking that last little bit of fuel in, and it's taking more air than fuel, and then it dies out. So that's why the motor would rev, all right? Having a huge vacuum leak where it won't start, what you're doing is you're adding the fuel. When you're choking it, it starts up, you close the choke, it dies. A really slight vacuum leak will be basically you get it started, it fire. It might even fire right up. It might take a little coaxing. Once you have it fired up, though, the idle is very erratic. All right, and then it'll drive you crazy. You know, you're playing with the air mixture screw. You think you got it, then the idle changes again. You go to idle it down, and all of a sudden it revs back up. Or you know, there's not enough idle when you go to turn it up. After you think you've got it at the right spot, it either goes up or goes back down again. It's an erratic idle. It's no good. And that's because it's sucking in air. How much air and how big a leak, you don't know because you just can't see it. But those are some major symptoms right there of having a vacuum leak. I've even had them where, like, for instance, on this dial intake, when the motor revs, like, it revs, and you can just tell the idle's just not perfect. Like, it's kind of up and down just a hair, but not super erratic. And then you rev it and you almost hear a bird chirping. It sounds like there's a bird in the motor. That's a vacuum leak. Let's move on to the next thing, which is engine compression. Engine compression is basically the volume of stuff. Basically the pressure, the volume of pressure that gets squeezed out as the piston comes up. And it has a place to go, and that's the exhaust pipe. So as the piston's coming up, your exhaust valve opens and pushes all that out, all that waste gas out the exhaust pipe. Compression basically equates to power, yes. It equates, like, to me on these motors, the more compression I can get, the torqueier usually the motor is, okay? What affects compression or more or less compression? Basically, piston size, how well you have your, the way the rings are clocked would affect that. There's a specific clocking. I don't know if I have it on a video or not, but you don't want your ring gaps to line up at all because it allows some of that air or pressure to get through. Okay. And you want all your rings should be clocked different. There's quite a few videos. If I don't have one, there's quite a few videos out there how to clock your rings. What else would affect compression? The cam choice, all right? Lower lift cams will create more compression than a higher lift cam. And the reason for that is that higher lift cams have what's called overlap. Overlap is when, during the four-stroke cycle, when it's going through and, you know, you have your intake stroke, compressions, I don't even know if it's the right order, intake stroke, compression stroke, expansion stroke, and then exhaust stroke. During those four strokes when the valves are going up and down, overlap is when both valves are open at the same time. And usually you'll find this on higher lift cams. If you ever heard a hot rod with a real high lift cam and it lopes and everything, it has really low vacuum. All right. They usually, if you talk to guys who have vacuum assisted brakes or whatnot, it's usually when you start having like vacuum problems, your brakes start to fade and whatnot. It affects vacuum. It affects the pressure of how much it's drawing in. It also affects what's going out. So it lowers the vacuum. It lowers compression, more importantly, and that's because of the overlap, because both valves are open at the same time as you're doing your compression check and you're spinning the motor over. At some point, the two valves are open at the same time, which allows more air to escape. All right, it's not a sealed system. A lower lift cam basically has less or zero overlap. So one valve is fully closed when the other valve is open. And that's why you get more compression with a lower lift cam. That's why lower lift cams are your A12, 13, and 14, your torque cams. And that's why like A8, 9, and 11 are your higher speed cams. Because what the overlap does is it causes a draft effect. And it pulls more fuel, and as you get to higher RPMs, all right, and we're talking about like it kicks in later, it's a top-end cam, it kicks in much later, and why it kicks in later is as the RPMs are spooled up and as you've got, you're cruising down the road, it causes a draft effect and sucks more fuel in and blows it out the exhaust. So it's kind of like between the two valves being open, it causes a vacuum or a draft effect to blow, take in the gases and shoot them out quicker, but it only happens at much higher RPMs, and that's why it kicks in later. Whereas a lower lift cam kicks in much sooner. It revs, it revs off the bottom quicker, and that's because you're keeping that compression in the motor. So, basically, low compression causes are basically rings. Would cause that, and remember, vacuum is in the intake manifold, okay? And then your compression is only from the top of the piston up, all right, to the valves, to the head, all right? There's no compression in the crankcase. There's no compression in your manifold. That's basically wherever the cylinder's lowest point is to the highest point. That's where compression lives. That's all it is. It's nowhere else in the motor except there. All right. Low compression would be wore out rings. Low compression would be valves not sealing anymore. Maybe you need a valve job. Maybe, you know what I mean? So, when I do port and polish work, or when I do head work or whatnot, or if I am repairing a head, the casting's good. You know, I redo a valve job, which is basically taking the valves and lapping them in your valve seat to match them up, to make them mate so they seal well. One thing, I'll bring this up because it actually puzzled me and I had to do a little research on it and whatnot. So if you are running a big bore kit, and we're going to get in, well, we'll use this as a segue to go from compression to crankcase pressure. Okay. So, crankcase pressure, let's explain what it is, and then I will explain what I was just going to say. So crankcase pressure is everything from under the from the bottom of the piston in the crankcase, in the motor, okay? And this crankcase pressure would be caused by basically, you know, the piston going up and down. You have compression on the top end, and then you have crankcase pressure on the bottom end. There are hoses that come off your motor. There's one on the valve cover. You put your valve cover on, and you have a nozzle, okay? Goes on the valve cover, and there's a hose that runs off of this. What is that doing? That's relieving crankcase pressure. That is taking the pressure from in the motor, the bottom end of the motor, and relieving it, okay? This tube here is the crankcase vent for your transmission, all right? All that spinning around and whatnot, it does cause pressure in there, and this is what relieves it. Now, if we didn't have those, you would build up enough pressure that would just blow the gaskets out of this thing. It can happen. Now, what causes a higher volume of crankcase pressure or more intense crankcase pressure? Big bore kits is one. Compression is another. The more compression you make, the more crankcase pressure you're going to have. So they all go hand in hand. Obviously, increasing compression, you put a big bore kit in there, it should increase compression. You're also going to increase crankcase pressure. So if you ever see the dipstick tube kits, that the vent hose that you hook to, you take out your dipstick and you put a nipple in there and it's got a hose, those breather kits are basically to relieve more crankcase pressure for big bore kits. Now, if you bought that first, you just bought a stock buggy, you figured, well, I'm mechanically inclined enough that I can buy this kit and screw it in there and put a couple of hose clamps on. You really didn't do anything for yourself, because a stock 150cc motor, a stock 155, or not a stock, but even a 155cc big bore kit really isn't going to create a substantial amount more of crankcase pressure that's going to benefit you. All right. And I'll actually explain how that hose benefits you anyway. So the more that you got going on top, the more power, and power is a slippery slope. You change one thing and then you got to change like five other things to either complement it or compensate for things. The big bore kit, you know, you put a big bore kit on there, and you create more compression, happy camper, but you also create more crankcase pressure. Now, crankcase pressure can have a negative effect. Not negative, but besides blowing gaskets out of a motor, it can also slow your motor down. All right, because it creates resistance for the crank, and when the crank and the rod is going around, it does create that resistance, okay? And what that would equate to as far as, you would lose RPM. So you're not really losing it because you don't have it, but there is a way to increase the RPM, get more RPM out of making all these changes, and that is that dipstick tube vent that we're talking about. And the first time I ever used it, I built the motor for my buggy, and I did not put it on. I put it with the normal dipstick, I put the oil in it, and I know it was like the day before first race. So I just got the motor done, slapped it in the buggy, got it fired up, and took it down the road with the dipstick. and then pulled in because I wanted to see, it was my first time using it, I wanted to see if there was a difference. Put the dipstick tube on there, or the vent tube on there, and yeah, if I didn't gain, I didn't have a tack on it, but I could hear it, and it sounded like it might have climbed another extra 1,000 RPMs just from that. And what I did was, what I was doing by that, was relieving all that crankcase pressure, which slows down the crank. It slows down the moving parts. It's resistance. It's like wind resistance, I guess, for lack of a better term, for the rotating parts in the motor, okay? Not necessary if you're running stock motor. Not necessary if you're like running a 155. But if you're going like with a 61 and you're starting to go extreme with the cam and adding things, you know, exhaust and you know, you're building a motor the way you should, then that thing will come in handy. If you have a 200 plus compression motor, it definitely benefits you. Okay, definitely. And when I build motors, usually like my rule of thumb, like if I'm building a standard motor for someone who wants to run pump gas, my goal is to keep it 200 pounds or lower. If so, they can go, you know, they can buy high test pump gas and use, you know, premium, and they don't have to buy race fuel. Anything 200 and up, I usually recommend running 100 octane plus. All right. And that's to keep from detonating pistons, melting pistons, and it won't take long. I've seen 225 motors on pump gas basically to get an hour out of them before the piston had a dish melted in it. Back to crankcase pressure. So yes, it does work. It does relieve crankcase pressure. I guess one more thing I will add, because we were just talking about, because I know somebody might be scratching their head and is like, well, how do you keep it 200 pounds, you know, with the same parts? Like, MBX is a 61 millimeter piston. 90% of my builds for customers are 61 millimeter piston sets. So how do I different? Well, there's two ways. A, using a different head. So if I'm using a 60 on a customer's, if I'm using a 61 millimeter cylinder, I might use a 61 millimeter head. Chamber's a little bit bigger. Might even use a 63 millimeter head because the chamber's a little bit bigger. If I'm building a race motor and I want more compression, I will use the 58.5 millimeter head. The chamber's a little smaller, get a couple extra pounds. The other way is I will detune a motor to keep it around 200 pounds. I might add an extra base gasket. And what that does is not allow, you know, as you, by adding a little bit of space underneath, it lifts the cylinder height up, just a hair, and we'll detune it just a little bit because the piston isn't at the very, very top. It might be just in the hole, just a hair. But it's enough to keep it at 200 pounds. So those are just tricks that, you know, some things that you do to do that. Cam selections also has something to do with it also. So going back to crankcase pressure, we don't want to blow the gaskets out of our machine. We want as much RPMs as possible. So if you are doing a big bore kit, then yes, the vent tube kit is a big help. I find that most of the vent tube kits for buggies, the hose is not nearly long enough. And so I might go buy my own hose in a couple feet. And what I usually do is route it out the back somewhere where if the buggy does roll over, because all that oil will just come pouring out of that tube and you don't want hot oil dumped on yourself. I've seen it happen. It's not pleasant. I would route that, you know, you just try and picture the buggy upside down. And if this does, where is this the furthest away from my passenger and my driver? And then make sure the tube always points down, A, in case it rains. B, if it's pointing down when it's flipped over, it should slow the flow, you know, going back uphill coming out. It won't just dump out. It'll have to work its way through gravity a little bit. The other thing I want to mention, while we're on the subject of dipstick tubes, okay, because I've seen this also. So usually when you put a dipstick tube, you will see, if you use a clear hose, you will see a little bit of oil. You know, as the motor's running, it'll pretty much be right at the, you know, I wouldn't be surprised if you didn't see oil in the hose, okay? Maybe an inch, inch and a half, 2 inches max. But when you rev it, the oil tends to go down because it's getting sucked back in, circulated through the motor. I'm talking about at idle. If you see oil traveling up the hose at idle, I would say about 12 inches, you know, and you just have your normal cord in there. Why is this at idle? going up, and then when you rev it, it doesn't really suck back in, but kind of goes up higher in the hose. What's happening is you need to change your rings probably. You have, what's going on is, because the rings are shot, chances are that you're sucking air. So you're sucking, you know, you're getting your air fuel through your intake, all right? And it's getting sucked in on the intake stroke. And what it's doing is that some of that air and, you know, that volume of pressure that's should be compression is leaking its way down into the crankcase and causing more crankcase pressure. So it's actually like a pump. Your piston's working as a pump and actually sucking air down into the crankcase through the rings and still blowing out and doing what it's supposed to be doing. But in the meantime, as you're doing that, you're blowing the oil higher and higher up your hose. Okay, so it's time for a ring change. You're losing compression, and what's going on is you have a bunch of bleed coming in through the intake, going down into the crankcase. Not fuel. I'm not saying that you have a fuel leak, like, you know, when your float gets stuck and you fill up the cylinder with gasoline, and then it gets down and gas washes the rings, and then you open your dipstick and you have, my oil smells like gas. Not necessarily, but the volume of pressure that's in your intake getting sucked through your carburetor or whatnot, that pressure is actually working negatively and making more crankcase pressure. All right, it's bleeding through your rings, so your piston's acting like a pump and actually filling up your crankcase, and it's still doing what it's supposed to do. So that's a telltale sign. If you see that your idle, you know, let's say you've got one of them tubes, you've been running and everything's cool, and then like a week later you notice that at idle that level keeps on getting higher in your tube, it's probably time for a ring change. Time to do something over there. So hopefully I explained everything to you in a way that this will help you diagnose things and fix things and have a better understanding. So we have our vacuum pressure, which is created in here. Basically, it's from the point between the carb to the intake manifold. Okay, compression is basically from the top of the piston to the head. And then crankcase pressure is from the bottom of the piston throughout the rest of the motor, throughout the crankcase. All right. If you have any questions, leave them in the comment section. If you like what you see, or, you know, even comments, hey, you know, nice job. Hey, wear a different hat. Hey, you know, whatever. If you have any comments or questions, leave them in the comment section. If you like what you see, like and subscribe. I'll try and keep this useful for everybody. And I like to share stuff. I like to, it's kind of my way of being able to visually demonstrate some of the buggy stuff that's going on. If you need parts, go to gotbuggies.com, and you can follow MBX on this channel, and there's an MBX Facebook page. It's called MBX Revolution Racing. But thanks for hanging in there, guys, and until next time, JD's out.